Wolf v. Milbrae has previously been submitted and will take up Flextronics International versus Panasonic Corporation.
Morning, Your Honors.
Good morning, Mr. Tompkins.
I'm here with my colleague, Evan Boyle, representing Flex, the appellee. Flex alleges that the appellants agreed among themselves to restrain trade in the market for capacitors. They did so by reaching price and production coordination agreements, by allocating markets and customers, and by targeting the prices of large customers like Flex, whose prices set market benchmarks. The appellees did this in part using the same subcommittee of the same Japanese Trade Association that was used to further the conspiracies alleged in the resistors and capacitors case. The appellees met at those subcommittee meetings, JADA subcommittee meetings. They exchanged their confidential price and production information and their forecasts of that same confidential price information. I underscore here for the court the word confidential. Prices in the inductors industry are set by individual negotiation or bidding almost entirely, and they are confidential, highly confidential, the most closely guarded secrets in the industry.
Let me ask you a question. You have in your complaint, you know, statements about it's not time to reduce prices, ongoing price corrections, suppression of price reductions, but you don't characterize that as invitations to collude in your briefs, and you don't cite invitations to collude as a plus factor in your complaint. Can you explain, do you consider that to be an invitation to collude or not?
We did argue in the brief, Your Honor, that the statement now is not the time to reduce prices, which I believe was made by NCC's president, who at the time was president of JADA, was an invitation to collude, and an invitation to collude is a well-established plus factor. We did not argue that point as a separate plus factor in the briefs because the evidence, the record is clear that there's more than sufficient evidence that the defendants restrained trade in the market for inductors without mentioning the invitation to collude, which did involve admittedly a non-defendant speaker. That example you're citing. The point that the inductors market is prices are confidential is critical to understand because it distinguishes
the price correction, price reduction, suppression. That's a Panasonic employee. That is a.
Oh, I'm sorry, Your Honor. Yes, I think you're referring to it as not the time to reduce prices.
Right. Yes. That is the chairman of JADA, not a defendant. How could you ever have a price fixing case without parallel conduct? Separate from parallel pricing, how could you ever have a price fixing case without parallel conduct?
I'll give an example. You know, the Evergreen case out of the
first. Or parallel pricing, excuse me. Parallel pricing out of the equation. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, the Evergreen case in the First Circuit is a case in which the competitors are alleged to have taken a series of actions to exclude a potential market entrant, an aspiring market entrant. And in that case, the actions are not entirely parallel because the common motive, allegedly, was to prevent this new market entrant from joining the market. Similarly, in the high-tech employees case, there was parallel agreements as to seven parallel agreements that covered seven defendants, but all 21 of them were not covered by precisely parallel agreements. But you're right, Judge Koh, that generally speaking, you know, conspiracy cases are going to allege some form of parallel conduct. And most of the time, that is going to be true. And oftentimes, a failure to allege any parallel conduct is going to suggest there wasn't a conspiracy, as in the bona fide case, the appellee's site, which is unpublished, but which involved a situation sort of like Evergreen, where the allegation was that the defendants in that case had taken various actions to exclude a potential market participant. But in that case, the court said the actions were so dissimilar, and critically, there was no evidence that they had any common reason to exclude that plaintiff beyond the simple reason of not having another competitor, that they each individually share. The thing that distinguishes this case from musical instruments and from the DRAM case is that in this case, there is no pro-competitive justification for information that was shared. There is no plausible, and I would submit no, even neutral explanation for in a market where prices are confidential, sitting down with your competitors and telling them your current prices and your future prices. In the musical instruments case, the price exchanges were in service of a lawful purpose, that is implementing the minimum prices that a common customer wanted. And in the DRAM case, of course, it's not illegal to reduce your capacity. Here, this is like coordinated pretrial, where this circuit said that there's no reason to put these price announcements out there except to tell your competitors that you're moving prices. And there's no competitive reason to do it. And here, there's no competitive reason, similarly, for the defendants in this case, the appellees specifically, to share their confidential price and
production. Can we talk about your market conditions a plus factor? You're alleging it's a plus factor. The defendant's global market share declined 7% during the conspiracy period. Can you explain how that would be consistent with all of your other allegations that there were barriers to entry, few new market entrants, consolidation, that the Chinese citric acid manufacturers had difficulties in the marketplace because their products were viewed as low quality or lower quality?
Yeah, I mean, the conspiracy wasn't perfect. Over the course of time, the conspirators, despite their best efforts, did start to lose market share. Although I note that those numbers you're citing, Judge Koh, are worldwide numbers. And in the United States, as we allege in our complaint, my recollection, in the United States, as we allege in our complaint, for U.S. customers, Chinese entrants to the market were not able to make substantial progress until the very end of the conspiracy period. If you look at our figures near the end of the complaint, the numbers go from 6% to 16% right around the time to Flex's purchase, right around the time the conspiracy fell apart when the DOJ investigation became apparent. So, but you're right that the conspiracy wasn't perfect, and so just like the conspiracy, I'm sure, did not eliminate price erosion, prices did fall, generally speaking, over the class period, it slowed that erosion. And it slowed the rate at which other competitors could have and would have entered the market. The district court did not credit Flex's allegations, despite their specificity, despite allegations as specific as better prices were assessed while we suppressed price reduction. Despite comments like that, the district court didn't credit them, primarily because the district court got caught up in the supposed requirement that parallel pricing allegations are required, and they aren't. There is no case law that says or suggests, certainly not in this circuit and not in the Supreme Court, that a plaintiff must allege parallel pricing. In fact, the case law is to the contrary. There is no allegation of parallel pricing in the musical instruments case. No allegation of parallel pricing in the DRAM case, also from this circuit, and there's no allegation of parallel pricing that was integral to the case in the Twombly case. All of those cases, well, different agreements for restrained trade that inflated prices, they didn't necessarily cause prices to be parallel. And critically, in none of those cases did the court articulate anything to suggest that parallel prices were the sine qua non of an antitrust complaint.
But let's talk about, you do try to allege parallel pricing, right? You say if there's a 5% differential between the prices of Murata TDK token and Panasonic, Sagami, and Sumida. What if that 5%, that's just the market? That is the market for that product?
We did try to allege parallel pricing, and I think we did adequately allege it under the circumstances, relying on the expert that we retained after the first dismissal order. But you're right that the parallel pricing allegations, certainly as to appellees, are not perfect, because again, prices are confidential. We allege parallel pricing. We said prices moved in parallel throughout the conspiracy period, and we said they tended to move together. and as to some appellees tended to come together later in the conspiracy period. But we had to allege the most of those allegations based on public data that the district court held was not specific enough. There was no way to plead more specific data because, again, prices are confidential. As to some defendants, we had enough purchases, Lex is a very large purchaser, that we could perform statistical analysis. But as to appellees, we could not. But that can't be a bar to the courthouse door, because if it were, then you would have to have purchased large quantities of every product from all of the defendants when you allege a conspiracy in a market where prices are confidential. And that is not the law at all. It is absolutely clear that if you purchase from one conspirator, you don't have to purchase anything from other conspirators, and they're still liable because of joint several liability.
Did you say that you wanted to reserve any time for rebuttal or not? I didn't hear that.
Yes, I don't know if I mentioned it, but I was going to reserve 4 minutes. But I'm happy to reserve 4.5 if the court has no further questions.
Okay, yeah, you may reserve 4.5. Mr. Garr.
Thank you, Judge Wardlaw, and may it please the court. After giving Flex numerous opportunities to fix its defective Section 1 claim, the district court properly concluded that Flex's fourth amended complaint should be dismissed and this litigation should come to an end. There's no basis for this court to overturn Judge Davila's careful handling of this case and allow Flex's claim to proceed any further. I'd like to begin with some context, Your Honors. The smoke that precipitated this litigation was a report of bid rigging by a separate set of defendants with respect to a particular customer. But the big rigging defendants have been dismissed from this action, and all that remains is a general price-fixing claim with respect to the defendants here, which has nothing to do with the bid rigging that was reported, and that's based solely on an allegation that these defendants exchanged pricing and market conditions information at JADA Trade Association meetings.
Counsel, here's my problem with the case. We're talking about motion to dismiss, right? And there are allegations in the Fourth Amendment complaint suggesting pretty robust information exchanges. There are a number of allegations that go towards the plus factors. It may not be good enough. They're expert on parallel conduct and like for purposes of summary judgment. But we're talking about a motion to dismiss outright. So it seems to me that the district court review and analysis of the plus factors seem to kind of take it in isolation in these little buckets and analyze it. And as I understand it, you're supposed to look at it holistically and determine whether it survives a motion to dismiss. So I'm not sure that the really cramped reading of these allegations and putting them in isolation is the right way to construe this complaint. Where am I going wrong in this?
Sure, Judge Wynn. Well, I think that's an unfair characterization of what Judge Davila did here. And I think, you know, look, ultimately they have to meet the legal requirements for stating a claim under the pleading standards that this court is well aware of. I mean, just to start with parallel conduct, because that is an element that this court has looked to in this sort of claim that others have as well. The sole allegation where they attempt to allege any parallel pricing is in paragraph 39 of the complaint. And that allegation includes a smattering of different products, prices for different products. It has only one price, for example, of Sagami's product, and it actually shows prices going down over time. So I think just to start with parallel conduct, there's absolutely no basis to find in this complaint and the allegations that they've alleged parallel pricing conduct. And with respect to the allegations of information sharing, granted, there are several pages in the complaint, but really what it boils down to is a discussion of allegations of aggregate average pricing information, things like market conditions and the costs of raw materials, and generalized conclusory allegations, which almost never refer to the specific plaintiffs, defendants before this court. And I'd be happy to walk through those allegations, but at the very most, Judge Wynn, they've come up with some smoke, but when you actually look at the allegations, there's really nothing there, as Judge Davila concluded. And I think, you know, what really gives away the game for plaintiffs here is the first page of their reply brief, where they have three bullets, which presumably amounts to what they think their best allegations are. And I think if you look at those three bullets, and it's on page one of their reply brief, I mean, the first thing that you would note is there's no citations to any paragraphs in the complaint. They're simply citing to what they've characterized in their opening brief. But when you go—
What about the allegations relating to Dr. Lamb analyzing the purchase data and indicating that prices for similar conductors moved in parallel throughout the conspiracy period?
So of course, Dr. Lamb was an expert, and there's no case in which we're aware of where a court has relied on expert opinion about a legal issue in determining a motion to dismiss. I think, you know, even more than that, Dr. Lamb's focus was on parallel pricing conduct of the defendants that have been dismissed from this case. Again, with respect to the defendants that are remaining here, really the only allegation of any parallel pricing is in paragraph 539 of the complaint, which is utterly lacking. And the lack of any parallel pricing really does distinguish this case from the others that we're aware of. In the Bonafide versus conglomerate decision of this court, granted it was unpublished, but there the court said that, you know, given that there are no there's no allegation of parallel conduct here, we don't even need to get into the plus factors. The Eighth Circuit in the Park Ermet case said the same thing. My friend referred to the DRAM and the Evergreen case, but in those cases, there was parallel conduct alleged. In fact, in the DRAM case, I believe it was undisputed. And so therefore the courts engaged in a discussion of the plus factor. What's unique about this case is they failed to provide any plausible allegations of parallel conduct or a plus factor, certainly in the form of the alleged information sharing. I mean, the two prior cases that are most noteworthy of this court involving allegations of information sharing are the Citric Asset case and the Musical Instruments case. And the allegation—
Question. If I look at Judge Davila's February 22 order, on page 5, it says, in this case, because Flextronix relies solely on circumstantial evidence, it must allege facts tending to exclude the possibility that defendants acted independently, citing Citric Asset. Citric Asset was a motion for summary judgment case, and that quotation, quote, tending to exclude the possibility that defendants acted independently, end quote, is from Matsushita, which is also the standard for summary judgment, right? And then he repeats that in the August 2020 order under the circumstantial evidence section. He says, without direct evidence of a market-wide conspiracy, plaintiff must plead circumstantial evidence of a conspiracy that tends to exclude the possibility that defendants acted independently. Now, Twombly says that is the standard for summary judgment. The plaintiff's evidence must tend to rule out the possibility that defendants were acting independently. Twombly says on motion to dismiss, you just have to require a complaint with enough factual matter taken as true, which we have to do on a motion to dismiss, to suggest that an agreement was made. Asking for plausible grounds to infer an agreement does not impose a probability requirement at the pleading stage. It simply calls for enough facts to raise a reasonable expectation that discovery will reveal evidence of illegal agreement. And of course, a well-pleaded complaint may proceed even if it strikes a savvy judge that actual proof of those facts is improbable and that a recovery is very remote and unlikely. And so it says, when allegations of parallel conduct are set out, in order to make a Section 1 claim, they must be placed in a context that raises a suggestion, of a preceding agreement. So I don't think you really answered Judge Nguyen's question. Like, aren't you, and didn't the lower court sort of impose a higher standard than motion to dismiss?
I don't think so.
Not push it over plausible.
I agree with your characterization of Twombly and Iqbal. The standard that applies here is whether they've shown not just the possibility of unlawful collusion, but they have to show allegations that would suggest that an unlawful agreement was was actually plausible. And the Supreme Court in Twombly and Iqbal, you know, did underscore the line between possibility and plausibility. So that does matter. I mean, this court in the musical instruments case affirmed the grant of a motion to dismiss. It did the same thing in the bona fide conglomerate case, granted an unpublished decision, but applying the same standard. And if you hold this case up to musical instruments, I mean, this case is a much easier case on a motion to dismiss for the defendants in musical instruments. In musical instruments, there was parallel pricing. As Judge Pragerson noted in his dissent, there were allegations that prices actually increased as demand fell. And in that case, the allegations of information sharing were much stronger as well. In fact, in that case, the FTC itself had opened an investigation.
Instruments, that was a 9,000 member organization. They had open meetings. Trade press were there. Media were there. They were publishing information about what was going on in those meetings. I think there are a lot of ways that you could distinguish what happened in musical instruments. But let me ask you another question. You know, the other point in the lower court opinion is that you have to have parallel pricing, that you can't proceed unless you allege parallel pricing. And that seems inconsistent with Twombly, which just says any set of facts consistent with the allegations in the complaint would be sufficient. And I don't think there's any case that says you can't have a price fixing case or Sherman Section 1 Act case without an allegation of parallel pricing. Even DRAM found that, you know, contemporaneously restricting production was enough and didn't require parallel pricing. What is the authority to say that you have to allege parallel pricing as the lower court required, which I don't see any, authority that says you can't state a claim if you don't allege parallel pricing. That's certainly not in Twombly.
So, Your Honor, what I would say is this. First, I think you do have to show parallel conduct. After all, we're talking about a conspiracy towards an unlawful agreement. You have to show parallel conduct. In a parallel price-fixing case, the parallel conduct that matters is parallel pricing conduct. And this court, in the bona fide conglomerate case, said because they hadn't shown parallel conduct, that was the end of the case. There was no need to consider the plus factors. The Eighth Circuit in the Park Ermut case, which is a published decision from the Eighth Circuit, said because the plaintiff had failed to plausibly plead parallel conduct, no discussion of any plus factors is necessary. We're not aware of a single case in which a complaint alleging price fixing has proceeded without any plausible allegations of parallel pricing.
If you agree to restrict production, wouldn't that all affect price? And that could as price fixing, but you're not actually, I guess when I read Twombly, I don't see Twombly as saying we're going to put a straitjacket on these types of causes of action. Unless you have this and this and this, you cannot survive motion to dismiss or satisfy Rule 8. And so I don't see any case saying, okay, unless you have specific X, you cannot survive a Rule 8 or 12b6 challenge.
Right. So I think, Your Honor, bona fide conglomerate and program that speak to that. But with respect to Twombly, I mean, the starting premise of Twombly was that you had to show parallel conduct, but that parallel conduct was not enough. Again, I'm not aware of a single case in which the court has said you don't even have to show parallel conduct. But the, fundamentally, the problem with the plaintiffs in this case is that they haven't plausibly alleged either parallel conduct in the form of pricing or a plus factor in the form of the information exchanges. And I just want to, I think it's very important.
I didn't hear the answer specifically. What is the authority that says you cannot allege a price fixing case without alleging parallel pricing? What is the authority for that point?
I'm
putting parallel conduct in a separate bucket. Parallel pricing, as this lower court required, what is the authority for that point?
So I think both, Your Honor, both the bona fide conglomerate and Park Ermut case speak to that. And they speak to that in terms of the relevant parallel conduct. I'm not aware of a single case in which a court is allowed a claim to proceed where there was no, a price fixing case, where there was no sufficient allegations of parallel pricing. Because after all, at the end of the day, their claim is that there was unlawful agreement to fix prices. And if they can't even show that prices had moved, I mean, if you contrast this case with the Seventh Circuit's decision in the Inri text messaging case, there you had allegations of information exchanges.
Let me ask you another question then on this parallel pricing. What they allege is that they have, I guess, their statistical price analysis on Murata, Tayo Yuden, and TDK. And then they say that they made purchases from the defendants in this case, Panasonic, Sagami, Sumida, at prices that were consistent with those other firms' prices at given purchase times over the time period here, and that for Panasonic and Sagami, two of the three defendants, they had the same median trend lines, that, and then they merged and became identical by 2012. Why is that not enough to allege parallel pricing?
So I think, as Your Honor noted, most of those allegations concern the defendants that are not here. I mean, the only ones that pertain to the defendants that are here are in paragraph 539. And they don't, you know, I think if you contrast that allegation with the allegations as to the defendants who are absent, you would see the absence of any attempt to show what Judge Davila showed, said was any attempt to show trends, patterns, or relationships in pricing over time, and it's completely absent. And I would like to correct the notion that these prices are highly confidential and unavailable. With respect to some of the firms, that may be true, but prices are widely available generally. In fact, if you go online and look at Sumida's prices for inductors, you could find them today. And in this case, the defendants like Sumida actually produced more than a decade of pricing information to plaintiffs early in the litigation. They did so in the direct class action, and then they did so again in this case. And yet, in the face of over a decade of information like that, all they could come forward with is the allegation in 539, which is utterly insufficient and doesn't establish a plausible case of any parallel conduct under the pleading standard. Your Honors, with respect to the allegations about the information sharing, I do want to stress that all they have,
but I'll leave it to our presiding judge.
Well, I'm sorry, Your Honor, I thought I had a minute left.
No, you don't. But please just finish your point. You can finish your point. Although I do have to observe that you continually slip back and forth into arguing facts on the ground, inviting us to go on the internet and look up the pricing of inductors when we're really supposed to be just looking at the allegations in the complaint to determine whether they're plausible or not. So I can understand why Judge Davila was tempted to go apply the summary judgment standard if this is how the case is being argued and presented.
Well, with respect, Your Honor, paragraph 544 refers to the information that was exchanged to defendants about pricing in the complaint. I don't think Judge Davila applied an improper standard. I think he applied the correct standard. He looked at this case, four separate versions of this complaint, gave the plaintiff multiple opportunities to fix it, and I think correctly concluded that they had failed to show either the requisite parallel conduct in any plausible fashion or any plus factor that this court has ever recognized, particularly in the wake of Citric Asic and that musical instruments case. So we would urge the court to affirm the decision below.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Garr. And Mr. Tompkins, you did reserve a few minutes.
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. I will take some of these points in reverse order if possible. Parallel price requirement, as Judge Koh mentioned, was just invented during the course of this case. There is no requirement that you allege parallel pricing in the context of Section 1 Sherman. The text messaging case, the court noted that under certain circumstances, historically unprecedented price increases simultaneously could potentially suggest conspiracy, but it has not come close to alleging a requirement that any plaintiff alleged parallel.
It may not be a requirement. It's pretty tough to do a price-fixing case without it.
Well, Your Honor, that's because if you call it a price-fixing case, and appellees, you know, do this, but price-fixing is just a shorthand that antitrust litigants use to discuss cases where there's restraint of trade. I mean, if you look at the musical instruments case, the very first sentence of that case is we have to conclude whether the defendants, the appellees, fixed prices. That case doesn't have to do with price fixing. It has to do with whether or not the whether or not the defendants had illegally conspired to implement an advertising policy regarding minimum prices. It's not a price fixing case in the sense that you might use it, colloquially.
And so sure. I'm just talking about as a practical matter to get through summary judgment and prevail at trial.
Well, as a practical matter,
you're going to need more.
Well, once we have access to discovery, of course, we are hoping we'll have more than we have at this stage. I mean, we have received some pricing data, but it was incomplete. It doesn't cover all the time periods, doesn't cover all the prices. And critically, as Judge, I think it was Coe mentioned, the prices, we allege the prices in paragraph 692 are confidential. And we base that on, purchases of millions of dollars of inductors over the relevant time period. So that allegation is entitled to truth and it's non-conclusory. So there may be some prices on catalogs, but as to individual customers, there's a negotiation process and often as the complaint reflects a bidding process to govern those prices. I'll address briefly the Park, Ermat, and the bona fide cases because, the parallel conduct and plus factors analysis. Sometimes in these cases where what you're trying to do is look at the context, the totality of the circumstances, and see if it's plausible to infer a conspiracy. The labels don't help. In Park Ermat, that involved mail order pharmacies that allegedly excluded another pharmacy from the market. And the court said that the policies they adopted 6 months apart weren't sufficiently parallel conduct. Now contrast that with DRAM, where this court said that the capacity reductions didn't happen close enough in time to be a plus factor. In both cases, the analysis is that the conduct wasn't sufficiently similar, wasn't sufficiently close in time to suggest anything than a pro-competitive explanation for the conduct. The precise language used in both cases doesn't matter. The same thing is true in the bona fide cases. That case involves a series of random actions to exclude a government subcontractor, and there's no reason to believe they're coordinated based on the facts of the case. And the way the court mentioned that was in terms of parallel conduct, but could have just as easily said there was no evidence of evidentiary allegation to support the existence of a conspiracy. And I want to end on that note. I know my time is ending, but you haven't heard any pro-competitive explanation or even a neutral explanation for these information exchanges because there isn't one. And that does distinguish this case. A lot of cases are hard cases in the antitrust context where you've got to figure out whether reducing capacity is based on competitive concerns or collusion. This isn't such a case. This is like coordinated pretrial where there has been no competitive explanation proper and there just isn't one. It should be easy to rule the information exchanges here were indeed motivated by collusion. Thank you for your time, Your Honor. We appreciate being heard.
I thank both counsel for excellent arguments. Flextronics versus Panasonic will be submitted.